Hi. Oh, I can't be distracted by the cute puppy. Oh my goodness, I love me some cute puppies. Have you guys seen that picture? It's going around social media. It's pretty funny. It says, if I ever win the lottery, I won't tell anyone, but there will be signs. And it just shows like a parade of dogs or like around this person. I was like, that would be me. I love my puppies. Okay. Hi, welcome. Welcome back. Did you all get a nap?
Yes.
I wasn't planning on it. You didn't leave here till 3. Amy needed a nap. I went home and I took a nap. I needed one. Well, hopefully you guys feel refreshed and energized and ready to receive. Look at you guys moving to the front rows. You know there's more anointing in the front rows. You know that, right? That's what I hear. All right, well, welcome back. Welcome to everyone who's watching online. We are happy to have you online as well. Just as a reminder, we do have water back there. Of course, we have restrooms. You guys know that. I don't see any new faces, so I won't cover that. But of course, you guys, we still have our bookstore open back there, so make sure you guys take advantage of that. If you have not filled out your KOM Connect card, I'm going to encourage you to do that. You get a free download, so that's always a good thing, and it helps us stay up to date on your information. And so that way, when I feel like making prank calls at 3 in the morning, I got your phone number. That's important, right? I'm just kidding. We all know I'm not up at 3 in the morning. Okay. I want to do some giveaways. It says one medicine bottle, but I don't have a medicine bottle. Does someone want to give me one? And I'll give that away, too. But while we're doing that, Pastor Kurt did this teaching years ago called Navigating to Your Destiny. How many of you know that you're called to something? You're just not sure how to get there. I've been there, you guys. I've been there. I was like, I know what 45 steps down the road is. I just don't know what step 2 is, right? And step 2 is the wisdom of God. The wisdom of God will show you those steps to take. And Pastor Kurt does a phenomenal job laying this out in this USB, Navigating to Your Destiny. This is an oldie, but it is a goodie. So who would like to receive this? Should we go back to the early days where I just throw my giveaways? Who wants to be hit in the head? There's a reason I'm not doing games anymore, you guys. All right, so who truly, genuinely, come up here and get it. If you feel like you could really benefit from this teaching. We got a smaller group tonight. Anyone? Oh, look at this lovely bold lady. Give her a round of applause. It's all yours, my dear.
Thanks.
Mm-hmm. Okay, we also have a couple of books up here. Financial Keys and Professions. How many of you guys have this book? I know many of you do. So good, right? I told this morning about how Marcus and I used to be like flat broke. I legitimately flat broke, and it wasn't just like for a week either. We had to work our way out of that mess, right? And you know that back in the day, Pastor Kurt actually did this. He did this. It was a CD. That's how much, how dated, you know, because nobody uses CDs anymore, right? It was a CD, and he would say the financial scripture, and then you were supposed to repeat back after him. And my husband and I, we knew that we had to get out of that mess, and we literally listened to that CD, it was a CD, every single day. Pastor Kurt would say the financial scripture, we would repeat back after him, and we did that consistently for years. And we're not in a financial mess anymore, you guys. And I give all the honor and glory to the Lord because he got us out of that. And Financial Keys and Professions is essentially the book version of what Pastor Kurt did for us all those years ago. So who does not have one of these? Oh, this one young lady right here, she raised her hand first. You want to come up and grab one? Yes. Come on down. Dun-dun-dun. Dun-dun-dun. There you go. Who else could benefit from this? I don't want to throw it. I don't want to hit the dog. Oh, this beautiful lady over here. There you go, my dear. You're welcome. Okay. I got one more giveaway. Oh, look at this. I'm giving away some drugs. I'm just kidding. This is better. This is better than drugs, you guys. Better than pharmaceuticals. Okay, so we all know, right, just how we can utilize the word in our finances. We can utilize the word in our body as well. And you guys, I love this. I absolutely love this. I actually have one of these at home. These are scriptures in a bottle. And there is something psychological about this. When you pop open the cap and you eat the word, literally, sometimes I get really funny with myself. I'll be like, oh, that was some good word. Amy, your body is getting strong, right? Because we need to be really practical in our faith. That's what Pastor Kurt and Pastor Jerry teach us. And one of the ways that we can do that is by confessing the word over our body. So who needs healing in their body or knows someone that needs healing in their body? This, yes, come on up. You got to be bold. Yes. I'm making you guys work for your giveaways tonight. This is awesome. All right. But if you do not have this and you want this, we sell these in the bookstore. So you want me to throw it to you? How athletic are we feeling today? Woo! Good job. Nice work. As a reminder, you guys, prayer ministers are available before and after service, and I thank God for them because they are amazing, and they are anointed, and they will help you. Please silence your cell phones or place them on vibrate. What other announcements do we have here? I'm so bad at announcements. I'm like Pastor Kurt when it comes to announcements. Okay, what do we got? We got the second Friday of every month at 7 p.m. We have our Real Life Girlfriends meetings. If you are not part of this church and you would like a monthly meeting to come to and just be refreshed and energized and built up in the Word, I have to tell you guys, my mom, she's so sweet. I love my mom. She normally tries to come to this event every year, but for different reasons wasn't able to come this year. But she goes, Amy, I want you to know that your church is so special. She goes, those women, they're just the most loving women I have ever met. She goes, all churches are not like that. She's like, I go to a good church. They are not like that. They do not hug me like that, right? Because we do. We lift you up, right? And I will tell you, I know because I worked with a lot of women. Not all women are in your corner, right? It's sad but true, right? But we're in your corner. We're fighting with you. We're standing with you. We're not perfect. We are imperfect people that are walking this out. But we will stand with you, and we will be with you. And we do this every second Friday of the month at our women's meetings. And bonus, I get to tell you all health tips, which my husband tells me. He goes, how was your message today? And I go, you know, I think it was good. He goes, did you give him health tips? I was like, no. He's like, good. He's like, I think they're over your health tips, Amy. I was like, well, you know, we got to eat the spinach too, y'all, right? Okay. What else am I supposed to announce? Redeemed. Oh, my gosh. We have the theme already? Sorry, I missed the memo on this, you guys. Mark your calendar for 2024. We're having another retreat, and the theme is redeemed. Praise God. I'm going to fly down for that. That's going to be absolutely fantastic. Pastor Kurt is on, he has a podcast, you guys. How fun is that? It's called Fight to Win. It's also a TV show. You can take advantage of that. Get a little Pastor Kurt with you when you're on the road. And I think I did all the announcements. Okay, so the only thing left here is, Rose asked that word that the Lord gave me this morning for you all in terms of that restoration. So I actually did write that down. So but the way the Lord works with me sometimes is he will give me a word and I will write it down. He's done that for me personally. I've always been blessed by it. And so it actually was written down. And so I went ahead and put it on this pretty paper for you. So if you want to encourage yourself in that word, I do have it printed. So do you want me just to set them here and you can grab one, or do you want me to pass them out? Yeah. Pass them out. Okay. Okay. Well, I'm doing that. I'm going to invite Stephanie to come up, you guys, because we're going to do some games. It's going to be fun. Give her a round of applause. She's done an absolutely fantastic job.
Hi, ladies.
I brought my sword.
Hi. So today, we're going to do a game about the sword of the spirit. All right. So, I don't know about you, but when I first heard that the word of God was the sword of the spirit, like that's our weapon, you know the thing in your brain where it's like, that's too easy. Like, I just read this word and believe it, and then all of a sudden, like, things are supposed to start happening. But it's true. I've been through a lot of things in my life where the word of God was like, oh, that's how I'm making it through this moment. And, you know, sometimes it's just about getting through the moment. So, the first thing about the sword of the spirit is, like, it's heavy. Like, there's some responsibility there, right? And if you just walk in someplace and just start, you know, flopping it around without any training or skill or anything, you're going to cut some people. you're not going to mean to, and you're going to be speaking the word, but you're going to cut some people. So it's not only important to know the word and know that it's our weapon, but we also have to be trained in how to use it. And so, like, you guys can come pick it up later if you want to, but when you hold it, like, it's heavy. So if you're going to, like, go into battle and really, you know, get in there, and you're going to get tired, so you got to practice. So tonight we're going to do some sword drills, but with a twist. Let me sheathe myself. Okay. So we're going to do kind of a modified sword drill here. It's backwards. I'm going to give you a Bible verse, and then I'll give you multiple choice of three addresses where it could have came from. And the first one to find the right one, you get the point for your team. So I'm going to need 8 volunteers. Why? Because we want to give away 4 awesome prizes. So you know those prizes back there that aren't in the bags? Those are for tonight and tomorrow. So I need 4 volunteers twice. Yes, ma'am. Come on up. Raise your hand if you want to go. 2. Right there, ma'am. Yep, Margie. Yes, ma'am. Come on up. I need, yes, you 3 right here. I need 1 more. 1 more warrior to slash their sword. Oh, bring your Bibles. If you don't have a Bible, just, you know, we have some that we can grab for you. 1 Bible for the team will work, but for speed, I would recommend multiple. I feel like maybe a disadvantage at that point. Oh, so while we're getting Bibles and getting organized, I will let you know, ladies, I encourage you to get your own arsenal book. So you take the weapons in the Word, and then the ones that you're practiced in, the ones that you're like, this is some... Oh, you're right there. Yes, ma'am. There was 1 other person that raised their hand. Can I get 1 more volunteer? Okay. 1 more? Bueller? All right. Come on, sweetie. But yeah, I suggest you get an arsenal. So this is my book that, like, when my brain goes tilt is what I call it, and I'm just not thinking scripturally, or I'm not thinking the right things I should think or saying the right things I should say, I go to my book. These are my scriptures that I've pulled out that have touched my heart, or they speak to something in me that needs healing or correction or whatever I need at the moment, I can find in my arsenal. So I suggest you get your own little book and write down the scriptures that work in battle for you. Okay, so do we have Bibles? Yes, okay. So Calron has some slides for me. So the questions will pop up on the TV screens. Ladies that aren't volunteers, I encourage you to play along. All right, so let me get my 1 team of 4 to come all the way down this way. And my other team, you're fine. Okay. No, you're fine. You can get started. The first person to figure out which one it is, raise your hand, please. So the scripture is, therefore, you are great, O Lord God, for there is none like you, nor is there any God besides you, according to all we have heard with our ears. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. 1 point for this team. All right. Calron, our next slide, please. Therefore, take careful heed to yourselves that you love the Lord your God. Some of these are out of my personal arsenal. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. 2 points for team this side. New King James Version. I did them all in New King James Version. They're written down out of different translations in my arsenal, but you know. All right, Calron, we ready? Yes. Those who trust in the Lord are like Mount Zion, which cannot be moved, but abides forever. Do, 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 do. Yes. Oh. Yes. I forgot that was the one I switched on my thing, because when I looked it up in the New King James, it was weird. All right, so that's 3. Listen, there's still an opportunity to win, because I had 7 questions. You're good. You're not out of this, ladies. All right, He who has knowledge spares his words, and a man of understanding is a calm spirit. Yes, ma'am. Yes. 1 point for team this side. All right. Do not rejoice over me, my enemy, when I fall. I will arise. When I sit in darkness, the Lord will be a light to me. No. But I love you. Yes, ma'am. Yes. 1 point, team, this side. Okay, we are 3-2, just so you know, guys. All right, next one. He reveals deep and secret things. He knows what is in the darkness, and light dwells with him. Yes. Yes. Oh, my gosh. Ladies, this is the last question. We are 3-3. This is anybody's game. And I know y'all are jonesing for those paintings, so this is going to be a battle. All right, Cowron, hit me. I will plant them in their land, and no longer shall they be pulled up from the land I've given them, says the Lord your God. I love the sound of pages flipping. Do. Yeah. Oh! She got it right before you, girl. What is it? Wait. Oh, it is correct. Very good. Thank you very much, ladies. Okay, so ladies, your prizes are the ones that are unwrapped on the table. You can pick whatever you like. And just before I go, I just want to share with you one more verse. Oh, yes, yes. James 1:5. If anyone longs to be wise, ask God for wisdom, and he will give it. He won't see your lack of wisdom as an opportunity to scold you over your failings, but he will overwhelm your failures with his generous grace. I just really like that one. Thank you. Okay, who's ready to win some other prizes? Maya had to work tonight, so I have the fabulous Joan handing out prizes. I'm coming down here because I don't know how to do this with one hand. Hi. Our first winner is Paz. Where are you? I don't think she's here. Moving on. We're going to just pick another one. Super mom duties. Marjorie. Woo! Our next winner is Lee Santa. All right, ladies, our next winner is Jodie Latimer. Woo! All right, I'm going to mix them up, I promise. All right. Oh, we got a handwritten one. Charlene Thompson. Where you at? I'm going to put this one over here. All right. Linda Small. Yay! All right, how many do we have? One, two? Oh, last two, ladies. She's not here. Nikki Hart! No. Moving on. You're missing out on wonderful prizes, ladies. I'm just saying. I know life is important. Diane Petrigal, is that you? I can't pronounce it. I love you. Diane the Warrior. Okay, last one. Our final winner is Charlene Thompson. Yay! She's Yay! Sherry Gborg? Sherry's not here. I'm gonna just spend a minute with the bowl. Oh, I love you. Linda Glass. That was the best response. Thank you so much. See, I have discernment too. Holy hands, people. Thank you so much for playing with me, ladies. If you haven't gotten a chance to practice for the archery contest yet, the practice stuff is out there, and we're doing archery in the morning. It's got suction cups.
All right, ladies, ready to praise and worship the Lord? Yeah. All right, stand on your feet. There's a healer in the house today.
Healer in the house. Sometimes I wonder, is he faithful? Does he see me in my troubles? Does he understand? Sometimes I question if he's able. Can he rescue? Can he save me again and again? But when I look back, sometimes those voices try to tell me I've forgotten and I've fallen too far from his hands. But I know what kind of God he is, and I'm trusting in his promises and believing, and I'm singing, yes, he can. Did he move every mountain?
Going to come up and receive the offerings tonight. So come on, Amy.
You guys excited to give? Miss Ali, if you're watching online, I miss you. So Miss Ali was going to do the offering tonight, and she is probably one of the most excited givers I have ever seen in my entire life, and she does it like nobody else. But I will say that there is an honor, and there should be an excitement when we come before the Lord with our tithes and with our offerings, right? Because this is a girlfriend's meeting, offerings, because our tithes belong in your local church if you don't go to this church, right? But our offerings, there should be an excitement. There should be an expectancy when we bring our generous gifts before the Lord, right? And Pastor Kurt referenced this last night in Isaiah when it talks about, let's see if I can find it here. A generous man devises generous things, and by his generosity he will stand, right? So are you generous? We all get uncomfortable when we talk about money sometimes, especially in the church, right? We're like, ooh, I don't want people to think I'm asking for money. But at the end of the day, you guys, we live in an economic system, and it takes money to get things done in the kingdom. We got to talk about money. If we're not talking about money in the church, there's something wrong, right? Because money is important. Our heart towards money is important, right? And when your heart is right in your giving, watch out. Watch out The Lord has got a blessing for you so big when your heart is right, when you are a generous man and you devise generous things, and by your generosity you will stand. It says in Proverbs that a generous man refreshes other and he himself is refreshed. It also says if you cast your bread upon the waters, you will find it after many days, right? So if you sow your giving with a heart of expectancy, God will honor that seed. And he will bless it and multiply it back to you. In Psalms, it says, in Psalm 34, it says, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who trusts in him, right? We're called to trust in God, not in our money, right? Oh, fear the Lord, you his saints. There is no want to those who fear him. Think about that. There's no want to those who fear him. Over in Psalm 37, it actually talks about, he says, I have been young and now I am old, yet I have never seen the righteous forsaken, nor his descendants begging bread. This is one thing I really appreciate about the Jewish culture, is they understand the blessing of God, and they walk in it. I have some Jewish friends that are unbelievably blessed in business. Why do we not have that revelation? That when we follow God, he blesses us, and that we are called to be a funnel of finances in the body of Christ, right? So I want you to bring your offering tonight with a level of expectancy. What is it that you need? You know, we do not serve a God of lack, right? What we talked about today with toiling, do you know ultimately the root of toiling? It's fear of lack, right? We have to provide for ourselves. Our bank account has to provide for us. Our savings has to provide for us. It's something internal in us that just wants to work in angst, toil to get something in return. But we don't serve a God of lack. We serve a God of abundance, right? And when we honor him with our seed, he honors us back. I remember as a child growing up, my mom taught me this. We didn't have a ton because there was a lot of us. I came from a family of seven. But what we did have, my mom always taught me the importance of giving. I remember my dad wasn't working very much, and I was really, really little. And my dad was going to volunteer at something, and my mom gave her last jar of pasta sauce. I grew up in an Italian family, right? She gave her last jar of pasta sauce, and that was it. There was nothing else in the pantry. And my dad didn't get paid for like a week. We did not have any other food. But she said, you know what, God, I'm going to honor you with this. And she gave her last jar of pasta sauce. And I will never forget as a child watching my dad come home from this big event. And he just had these giant things of mostaccioli and sausage and peppers and onions and all these different things. God honored that seed and he blessed it back to her. It doesn't always have to be a big thing, you guys. What is your need today? What is it that you need from the Lord? Honor him with your seed and he will bless it back to you. I remember there was something the Lord put on my heart to give back in December. And it wasn't a huge seed, but it was a seed. And I just heard the Lord say in my heart when I gave it, and he said, I will honor that seed. And I was like, well, thanks. I appreciate that. And that built my expectancy. Do you know that it was not just 2 months later? I think that seed, it's on my heart to tell you this. I sowed a seed of $500. Do you know within a couple of months, I got a check for almost $7,500. And the Lord said, I honored that seed. Amen. He will honor your seed. Right? So whatever it is that the Lord's putting in your heart, you are sowing into good ground tonight. You are sowing into women being fed the word and the truth of God. And he will honor that seed and he will bless it for you. And you will see your needs not only filled and overflowed, but so much so that when you cast your bread upon the waters, it'll come back to you after many days. Amen? Amen. Amen. All right, let's bless the Lord with our seed tonight. Oh, huh. Well, you know, I don't normally do this. I don't know. All right, we got a text. Text to give, RLCPSL to 44321 if you want a text to give. Or if you need an envelope for your giving, we've got some amazing, beautiful women who are ready to do that for you if you need that. Do we do the confession over this? I'm a newbie up here, you guys. You got to help me. Okay. Guess put up the confession. I'm almost as good at this as Pastor Kurt is at announcements. Oh, praise God. I'm willing. All right, let's pray over our seed. And let's have an expectant heart, right? Father, thank you for wisdom and knowledge and spirit-led giving, jobs and better jobs, ideas and inventions, raises and bonuses, benefit sales and commissions, favorable settlements, estates and inheritances, interests and incomes, rebates and returns, discounts and dividends, checks in the mail, gifts and surprises, finding money, cars and better cars, houses and better houses, houses paid off, debts paid off, debt-free church building and land for Real Life Church, Port St. Lucie and Clewiston, expenses decreased, blessings increased. Thank you, Lord, for exceeding all of my financial needs, and that I have more than enough to give into the kingdom of God and promote the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen. Ushers, you may receive the offering. Is there anything else?
We serve, thank you, the great almighty God.
Yes.
And he is, we might be fearless, and we are now, as we've been taught. This is so good. Thank you.
This is so good.
Thank
Amen.
You.
Yes,
God
it
is just moving.
Yes, it
it's
is.
So good.
Yeah, it is.
But we have the song we want to share with you. If you don't know it, if you do sing, and everybody sing with us. And we're singing about our champion.
Amen.
And some of the words are, you are our champion, Almighty God. Giants fall when you stand. And they have already fallen as well. And they will continue to fall because we serve the Almighty Champion
Hallelujah.
Of all.
Hallelujah.
They fall.
When you stand.
Thank you. Giants fall when you stand. Undefeated every battle. Every battle he has won and he will win. He has won it all. He already did.
That's right.
Thank you. I'm glad to be in a house where they teach me the truth. So then in the course of this, it says, we are who you say we are. You crown us with confidence, and we are seated in the heavenly place, undefeated with the one who has conquered it all. Let's stand up. Let's
Amen.
Stand up.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Cal.
So hard to see it, took me so long to believe it. If you choose someone like me to carry your victory, perfection could never earn it. You give what we don't deserve it. Take the broken things and raise them to glory. You are my champion. Giants fall when you stand undefeated. Every battle you've won, and I am who you say I am.
it's because of his goodness, his goodness.
Good.
Father, we just thank you and we praise you for your goodness. You are a good God. You are faithful. You are true. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Father, we thank you tonight. We thank you for this weekend. We thank you for what you've already done through these services and through these messages, Lord. And that tomorrow when we leave here, we will be fearless. We will walk out of here in your strength and your power and in your love. And Lord, we just praise you and thank you. And I thank you tonight. I thank you, Father, that these ladies have ears to hear, that their hearts are open and receptive to your word tonight. We bind any weights, any distractions, anything that might hinder your word from going forth. We will receive everything that you have for us tonight, Lord. We just thank you, Lord. I thank you for the opportunity. I thank you for my pastors who have entrusted me to stand here to impart to these ladies tonight, Lord. I don't take it lightly. I thank you, Jesus, that you chose me to stand here tonight, Lord. And I thank you, Father, that this service will be milk to some and meat to others, but all will be fed. And I just thank you and praise you for what you're going to do tonight. I thank you. I have an expectation that people are going to be healed tonight, that people are going to be set free tonight, that people will be delivered tonight. And Lord, I just praise you and thank you for what you're going to do. Holy Spirit, have your way. Have your way tonight. We thank you, Father, that your angels are garrisoned about this building and on the inside and the outside to prevent anything other than the Spirit of God to operate tonight. And Lord, we just praise you and we thank you for what you're going to do. In Jesus' name, amen. Shalom. So good evening, ladies. How are you? God is good. He's faithful. And he's got something for each and every one of us, including me, tonight. And so we're going to just dig in and receive everything that he has. We have had some awesome messages. Pastor Kurt opened it up last night. And he said, put your focus on Jesus, that he must dominate our life. Amen. That we have to become established in righteousness. Amen. And all the promises are benefits, and they are all yes and amen to the glory of God. Amen. It was so good. So if you missed last night, you can go on our YouTube page and watch the services. And then Amy, she just preached her heart out this morning. And man, that was powerful. Amen. And she said, I will restore. The Lord said, I will restore the years. And she said, allow the Lord to restore you. That this is a partnership. It's not one-sided. It's a partnership. And that we don't have to toil. That's where we get tripped up when we toil. Amen? Amen. And she said, do you walk in feelings or faith? That was so good. I have that one starred in my notes. And it's a holy trust, she said. It's a holy trust. That was so good. And then Pastor Terry came, and she said, we should not render an opinion. We have to allow the Holy Spirit to take over and he's our opinion. Amen. That's what I got out of it. And she said, fear is authorized from the devil. Amen. She said, be more in tune with the spirit than with the natural. And that's so important if we're going to thrive. If we're going to walk out of here, just like this lady right here that we keep pointing to, fearless. Because we, in this day and age, we need to be fearless. We have to be fearless. This world is going to hell. That's just real. There's so many people, so many, Amy and I were talking, there's so many false doctrines. There's so many, even the churches are not preaching the word. They're allowing things that are not in the word to come forth through their pulpits. Amen. And we have to stand firm in the word. If it's not in here, then we don't preach it. That's what Pastor Curtin has taught us. If it's not in this book, we don't say it. It has to be based entirely on the word of God, not our feelings, not what we think. It's what he thinks. This is the higher authority, and that's what we believe here, and that's what we teach here. Amen? So tonight we're going to talk about being fearless and free from bondage. And I believe the Lord's going to just anoint this message, and it's going to touch your heart. Amen? We can live victorious lives free from bondage and fear. And God does not want us to be in bondage to anything, especially fear. Galatians 5:1 says, stand fast, therefore, in the liberty by which Christ Jesus has made us free. And do not be entangled again with the yoke of bondage. Sorry, Cal, I didn't give you scriptures. I was trying to write them. That was Galatians 5:1. I like how the Passion says it. Can you put that one up? Let me be clear. You got that, Cal? Okay. I hope this is what. Okay. It says, let me be clear. The anointed one has set us free. That's not the Passion. That's Amplified Classic. There it is. Let me be clear. The anointed one has set us free. Not partially, but completely free. He has not partially set us free. He wants us to have it all. He wants us to be free, truly free. Amen? Completely free. So God has provided a way for us to become free from bondage through his son, Jesus. In John 8:36, it's a familiar scripture. It says, therefore, if the son makes you free, you are free indeed. Jesus has made us free. So we have to walk in that. We have to get that down on the inside of us so strong that nothing can move us. Nothing can shake us. Amen? We were born, I think Amy said, we were born without fear until we had to contend with it. Oh, I think Pastor said that because she was saying Victoria didn't have any fear, right? We were born without fear until we had to contend with it. Fear is an unpleasant emotion caused by the belief that someone or something is dangerous, likely to cause pain or a threat. Fear. And one of the enemy's most popular weapons that he uses against us is worry, anxiety, fear, and uncertainty. And it can overwhelm us with the thick shadow of darkness, controlling our every move and decision. I know so many people who are in fear, and they're constantly looking out. They're seeing things that are not there. They're just afraid of everything, every little noise, just everything. I remember my mom used to be worried about us so much. It's like, Mom, stop worrying. We're fine. I'm just worried. Why are you worried? My husband sometimes does that. It's like, I'm a little worried. You know, if I'm sick or whatever, I'm like, honey, I'm fine. I'm good. I'm healed and whole. I walk in divine health. You don't have to worry about me because I am a child of God and he has me. Amen. I am protected by the blood of Jesus. Amen. Amen. And so much crazy is going on around us today. We fear wars, conflicts, persecution, violence, crime, natural disasters, terrorism, economic uncertainty, unemployment, divisions, disease, death, our children's future, our families, our financial future. We fear for our safety. The list can go on and on and on. It's a long list. There actually is a lot we could potentially be fearful of or worry about. There's so many things. Yet reality tells us that so much of what we spend our time being fearful about never happens. It never happens. Living under the weight of the what ifs is a hard place to dwell. We can't dwell in the what ifs. We have to dwell in what the Word of God says, who we are, what we can have. I think Pastor Kurt said that, or somebody. All the promises of God are yes and amen. And I think Pastor Angie said at one of the retreats, there's like 30,000 promises. How many's made that amount yet? No, I haven't. But there's much, much more that he has for us if we could just get past our fear and our worry and trust him. He knows what's ahead of us. He knows our future. He knows how to protect us. We allow him to. He knows what to do. But we have to surrender to him. Amen? Four things are sure. We will have trouble. Number two is how we handle the trouble will determine the victory. And we can either get into fear, doubt, or unbelief or uncertainty. And then that'll take us away from what we're looking for. Amen? We can take courage and have faith in the victory we have through Jesus. That victory gives us courage to know that we are protected. Amen? We choose not to trust God in certain areas of our life. We choose to blame God in situations we face. We choose fear over faith instead. Amen? You can't give your cart to God in pieces. He wants it all or nothing. He wants it all. He wants your whole heart. He doesn't want a piece of your heart. He wants all of you. All of you. So you can't be one side in the world and one side in the kingdom. That doesn't work. You can't straddle the fence. Amen. You can't straddle the fence. It's all or nothing. And we have to determine that, because every day we have temptations. We have things that pull us away that will take us from the Word of God, from our life in him. It's so easy to do. It's so easy to do. And if you don't watch it, man, you're going to be somewhere where you didn't want to be, where you didn't want to go. Amen. So we have to guard our hearts. Amen. Fear is a belief. We choose to believe instead of fear. We have to have faith in God and trust that he's in control if we permit him to. People always say, we've been taught this by both our pastors. God is only in control if we permit him to be. Like Amy said, we have free will. He didn't say, you know, this is what you're going to, this is, you know, you can do anything. No. We have to permit him to be in control. He's not going to take over your life. He's not. He won't. He gave us free will. When Jesus came, we got redeemed back into the kingdom of God. We got redeemed back into the kingdom of God. And if we lay a hold of what Jesus paid for, we can live an abundant life. Ask me, because you can walk away. You can walk away and you think everything's going to go great. But then the enemy comes in and things just start to go wrong. And I know for me, I made the choice. I made some choices that I didn't ask the Lord, because I was so young, I was so dumb, and I was sheltered by, you know, a Southern Baptist preacher and a mother who always worried. And so when something came along and I didn't know how to get out of it, I just surrendered to it. I surrendered to a marriage that was not for Rose, and I knew it. And I knew it, but I did it anyway. I didn't have a peace. I didn't have a, and for 24 years, I lived that life. Because I didn't know what to do. But God is so faithful. He's so good, because he brought me all the way from California to here. And I remember after I finally got the nerve to leave, I was standing in the shower, and he said, I had to bring you all the way from California to Florida to get you out of something that I didn't have for you. I just fell on my floor in the shower and just cried because he's faithful. And you know what? I found this church. I found Pastor Terry. She brought me to this church. I sat in the back. Pastor Kurt made me sit on the third row for many years. And he's like, you got to get this word down on the inside of you, Rose, because I was a wreck. And I was blaming myself. I didn't blame God, but I was like, he allowed it. But, you know, Lord, why'd you allow this? But he didn't allow it. I allowed it. But he was there to give me freedom. And he did through this church and through the word.
Amen.
Amen. Let's see. Philippians 4:6 in the New King James. He needs our cooperation to bring his plans to pass in our lives. He needs our cooperation. And it says in the New King James, be anxious for nothing but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. And then the Passion Translation says it like this. I like the way it said this. Don't be pulled in different directions or worried about a thing. Be saturated in prayer throughout each day, offering your faith-filled requests before God with overflowing gratitude. Tell him every detail of your life. He already knows it, but he needs you to say it. He needs you to tell him, because then you'll start recognizing those details and what's wrong and what's right. Tell him everything, because he already knows. You can't hide from him. He sees everything. He knows everything, and he loves you anyway. So you might as well tell him. Amen. You might as well get it right and just say it out of your mouth. It just releases you out from bondage and into freedom, and then it releases him to do what he needs to do in our life. Amen. 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 I like it in verse 7, too. It says, then God's wonderful peace that transcends human understanding will make the answers known to you through Jesus Christ. Jesus is our answer. Jesus is the Word. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us, right? It's all in here, right? We have the power to overcome fear. We have the power. Say that. I have the power to overcome fear. Say it again. I have the power to overcome fear. Amen. Isaiah 43 says, I didn't write down the, it says, fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. Do you understand that? You are his. If you've accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you are his. Amen. Amen. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overflow you. When you walk through fire, you shall not be burned, nor shall the flame scorch you. Amen. That's good. That's good. We can walk through fire and we shall not be burned. No flame will scorch you. Isn't that awesome? That is awesome. So I'm going to talk a little bit tonight about the account of Jesus walking on water. And the account appears in three of the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and John. But only in Matthew do we learn that Peter walked on water. Amen? And that's Matthew 14, 22. I think I'm going to do 22 through 33, Cal. Matthew 14. And then we're going to get into this. So they had just fed the 5,000, right? And so we take up here in 22, it says, immediately Jesus made his disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side while he sent the multitudes away. And when he had sent the multitudes away, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray. Now, when evening came, he was alone there. But the boat was now in the middle of the sea, tossed by the waves, for the wind was contrary. Now in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went to them walking on the sea. And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, "It's a ghost." And they cried out for fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them, saying, "Be of good cheer, it is I, do not be afraid." And Peter answered and said, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." So he said, "Come." And when Peter had come down out of the boat, he walked on the water to go to Jesus. But when he saw the wind was boisterous, he was afraid and began to sink. He cried out, saying, "Lord, save me." And immediately Jesus outstretched his hand and caught him and said, "Oh, you of little faith, why do you doubt?" And when they got in the boat, the wind ceased, and those who were in the boat came and worshiped, saying, truly you are the Son of God. So Jesus told him to go to the other side. He was going to pray. I'm going to show you a little clip, about just a few minutes clip, from The Chosen. I don't know if anybody's seen The Chosen, but this season they had Jesus walking on the water and Peter. And the storyline they used was that Peter, who was married, and his wife had some challenges, right? And so they were going through a situation, and they were mad at Jesus because he was healing all these people, but he didn't help them in their situation. So they were upset about that. Peter was really mad at Jesus because you're healing all these people, but what about us? Even some of his other disciples felt that way too. But so we're going to watch this little video. Cal has it for us.
John, keep rowing. What are you doing?
Did anybody just see that?
Over there!
I don't see anything!
What are we looking for?
Go! Go! It's a ghost! Go! 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 Let's go!
It can't be.
We have to get out of here! Everyone move!
Stop! That's not a ghost!
Are you crazy?
Have faith?
They
hasn't been my problem. I gave up everything to follow you. But your healing told of strangers.
Why do you think I allow trials?
I don't know!
They prove the genuineness of your faith. They strengthen you. This is strengthening you. And Eden. Keep your eyes on me. Simon, including hard things. Just keep your eyes on me. I promise.
Don't let me go.
I'm here. I'm always here.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Cal pulled that from, I don't know where we pulled it from, but we tried to get the best video that we could offline. And so I encourage you to seek out The Chosen and watch it. It's a great series. I mean, it's based on what the disciples went through. They're showing it through the eyes of the disciples. They try to stay true to the account, so that was really good. When we are going through trials and troubles, we are in fear. And our first reaction is to blame God. Like Simon did. Why are you doing this? You're helping everybody else. But you're not helping your own. Something against God settles in our heart. Where is God? Why is God not helping me? Why doesn't he help me? Don't you care? Don't you care, God? We ask him that. Don't you care what I'm going through? Don't you care I lost my job? Don't you care I can't pay my bills? Don't you care I'm going through a difficult relationship, marriage, divorce, whatever? Don't you care that I was just diagnosed with this? You name whatever you're going through. We get offended at God, and an offended heart can't hear from God. An offended heart can't hear from God. Your heart is closed. He needs your whole heart. We said that earlier. When Jesus commands you to obey him, this is what we're going to talk about. Jesus told Peter to come to him on the water, even though it made no sense. There was a raging storm all around them. Look at our lives. We have raging storms around us at times. Amen. This looked impossible. Fear was gripping the other disciples. They were like, no, Peter, don't do it. Don't do it. And people around us will tell us, don't trust God. Look at what's going on in your life, especially if they don't know him. They will tell us to stay in fear that this, you know, how is this going to work out? I just don't see any way. You might not see any way. There was times I didn't see the way, but God sees everything. He sees the way out. Amen. We can't fear. We can't let people around us, our family, nobody, keep us from what God has for us in the truth. Amen. Peter rose and said, tell me to come to you. And that's what we need to do when we're going through trials, when we're in fear. Go to him. He's calling you. Come to me. All you are heavy laden, burdened and heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. That's what he's saying tonight. Amen. Peter did just what Jesus said, and this is what obedience looks like, doing what Jesus says and believe him. Believe him that he's going to catch you. Believe him that he's there with his outstretched hand. What does obedience mean? The dictionary defines obedience as dutiful or submissive compliance. In simple terms, it means hearing the word of God and acting on it. It means hearing and then doing something with it. Pastor Kurt always says, what you going to do with this word you heard? He'll ask you, did you get something out of that day, out of this today? What are you going to do with it? We have to access every time we walk in these doors and we sit down and we sit under the word of God and we receive something, and then we got to ask ourselves, what are we going to do with this word that I heard? Am I going to walk out of this door and forget about it? Or am I going to go home and listen to the message? I'm going to open my paper Bible, and I'm going to put the word before my eyes. There's no distractions. You have your phone and your other devices, but people can text you in the middle of your reading. You can see something pop up that you want to look at on social media or an email or something coming through. But pick up this. Mine is all taped up because this is what I go to. And I sit here every service. I've been here 20 years and I have cases of notes. I take notes on everything. And then so I can see how far I've come. I even can see how Pastor Kurt and Pastor Terry has grown, because the things they taught 20 years ago, they've gotten so much more revelation. But I write it down because then I can say, oh, I remember that. I have that in my notes. I can go and look at that and it'll help me. And then I open my Bible and say, Holy Spirit, let me read this with understanding. That's what Pastor Terry, she said, pick up your Bible, but ask for understanding when you read it. You can't just read the Bible and think you're going to get it. You need the Holy Spirit, your teacher, your guide, your standby, your comforter to help you. That's why Jesus left him here. He said, I'm leaving, but I'm sending you somebody else that will help you. And he will help you to understand what you're reading. And it will change your life. Amen. Amen. It means, in simple terms, it means to hear from God and acting on it. It means aligning our will to God's will, doing what God has asked us to do. It is complete surrender to his authority. Complete surrender, not just a little bit, not halfway there, total and complete surrender to him. And I'm telling you, I'm a living witness. If you do this, you will see your lives transform. You will see everything that you ever dreamed of come true. I sat under this word for 14 years and I asked God to teach me about love. Because when I made the I said, Lord, I'm not getting married until you teach me this and you send me the one. I'm not doing this. 14 years for me to get it. And for who he had for me to get it, right? Amen. But after 14 years, he gave me a man after his own heart. Amen. Who loves me like God loves me, treats me. I can't even tell you how good he treats me. won't let me do nothing. Don't let me clean. Don't let me do laundry. Why are you carrying that bag? I was going to carry it out for you. You know what I'm saying? God is so faithful. But I let him, we got to let him be in control of our lives. And he will bless you. He will give you the desires of your heart. I promise. I promise that this word is true. I promise that what Pastor Kurt taught me and Pastor Terry, because we sat together. She wasn't a pastor. She wasn't a minister. We sat together on the front row for many years, and we got this word. And God gave her that man as her husband. She was waiting for her perfect man, and God did it. Amen. God did it. He wants to give you everything you desire. And so, you know, I was asking Gene, he's like, how'd you know? He's like, I bought the ring like 3 years ago. And I put it down, nope. I put it back, nope. I said, that's because you weren't ready. And I told God, whoever you have for me has to be ready, because I'm not doing this again. But if we wait on him, he will give us the desires of our heart. Because it is from him, and he'll give somebody that loves him like I love. He will give you somebody that loves him like I love him. And that does not, he doesn't mind if I'm coming to church 5 days a week. He doesn't mind if I'm doing retreats or helping Pastor Kurt in the ministry. I got to retire and come and help in the ministry, which was my dream, to work in ministry. And I'm doing that. And I'm changing lives. A lady called me the other day, and I picked up the phone, and it was a call from the ministry, and she said, Rose, I have a mammogram today. And I, like Pastor Terry's story, they saw something. And she said, I just called for you to pray for me. I said, okay, let's pray right now. What God has not planted in your body is dissolved and rooted out in Jesus' name. Amen. This can't stay in your body. Amen. It has to go. By his stripes you were healed. Therefore you are healed. We prayed the prayer. And about 2 o'clock. My phone rings, and she called me back. She's like, Rose, I had to call you back because nothing was there. Amen. Because I have faith. When I speak those words, it's got to move. Right. It's got to happen. Amen. And it will do it for you. Yeah. It will do it for you. Amen. Ask anything in my name, I'm going to do it for you. That's our daddy. That's my God. That's my Jesus who paid everything. Amen. Yes. Amen. Amen. It's complete surrender to his authority, and we base our decisions and actions on his word, not what we feel, see, or think. Obedience is the hallmark of salvation. We are saved by grace through faith in Jesus. In Ephesians 2:9, it says, "For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves. It is a gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast." It's not what you're doing if you're here 20 hours a week and you're working hard. But if you don't have faith in God and his word, that means nothing. Because then you'll walk around and say, I did this, and not God did this. He gives us the power, the mind, the information to do what he's called us to do. He teaches us every day how to do something. In my jobs, he taught me. In ministry, he's taught me. Thank goodness I had a great, great teachers. We have great pastors and ministers in this church. And what they teach is so important. But you got to do something with it. It is our obedience that set us apart as true children of God. John 14:23 in the Amplified Classic. I can get there fast. Have it right here. And it says, Jesus answered, if a person really, I like the Amplified Classic because they put those little extra so we get it. If a person really loves me, he will keep my word, obey my teaching, and my Father will love him. And he will come to him, and he will, and we will make our home, our abode, our special dwelling place with him. He will come to live with us. That eliminates all fear when we understand who lives on the inside of us. It eliminates fear when we understand who we are. I'm a child of God. When I wake up in the morning, I say, good morning. I say, good morning, Dad, and good morning, Jesus. Thank you for another day. And I can just see them. Oh, Rose is up. What do we got for her today? I got to watch this. She's got to do this. She's, you know, he's saying Rose is awoke. And I'm always wondering, Lord, how do you do this? How do you, you know, but we know the time. We just, he can do anything. But, you know, I was studying it out, and, you know, part of the world is dark when we come light. And so he got it all figured out. So when we wake up, we can he can say, oh, Terry's up today. What do we have for her? And he can see the future. And when we trust him, when things happen in our lives, he knows what to do. I told you yesterday or whenever about the my car incident a week ago. And I was driving. Coming from the airport. And the Lord said, turn off the radio and pray. I was like, and I can hear his voice. Hearing from God accurately. That's what I've been taught, to hear his voice. And it's a still, small voice. It's not loud. It's not screaming. It's that still, small voice. Turn the radio off and pray, Rose. I was like, okay. So I just prayed in the spirit because I didn't know what to pray for, so I prayed in tongues. So because I didn't know what I was supposed to pray for. So I'm driving, and I look, and there's this big piece of wood that was about that long and about that thick, and it was coming right for me. I looked over, and I didn't have time to even think, and it hit my windshield, the front windshield, and it broke. It didn't come through. It shattered. I got some little glass shards, but it didn't come through. And I was like, thank you. When I understood what he was doing, when I went back and remembered what he said, pray, he already knew what's going to happen. The enemy wants to steal, kill, and destroy us. But if we are listening to God, if we are reading our Bible, we can be free and we can be saved. Yes. He saved my life that day. My husband wrote on Facebook, ask my rib if God doesn't still do miracles. He calls me his rib. Ask my rib. That was a miracle. That was a miracle. And every day I thank him because I know he knows the plans that he has for me. Plans for good and not evil, to give me a future and a hope. Amen. 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 John, did I just read that? 14, that's 14:23, right?
Yes.
Okay. For a believer, that means surrendering our will to God. To sacrifice is to give up, to renounce, to destroy, especially for an ideal or belief that is not based on the word. We have to give up something that's not based on the word. If it's not in the word, I'm not doing it. Amen. What do you say? If it's not immoral, illegal, or unscriptural, it's okay.
Right.
But if it's one of those things, we don't do it.
Right.
We don't do it. We don't give the devil any place in our lives. Amen.
Yeah.
It's releasing something to the Lord that's valuable to us. We think we have it all, but we relinquish those things that we try to hold on to him, and he makes our lives better. Amen. Obedience to God is a way for us to get closer to him, to prepare for whatever he leads you to do, and to grow as a person. Jesus calls us to submit to his agenda, not to attempt to honor him with our own agendas. With our own agendas. He doesn't want our own. I don't want my own agenda. I learned that at 64 years old. I learned that. I want his agenda. I want all his promises. I was telling, I think it was Margaret, about the scripture that I prayed, because she's like, oh, you look so good. I said, yeah, Job 33:25 in the New Living Translation. I've been saying it, how long, when did Pastor Susan give us that? 12 years ago, I say it every day. My body will become healthy as a child's, firm and youthful. There is no wrinkles. Oh, we're watching, we're online too, right? Excuse me. But I gotta show off. I'm sorry, I just went a little bit, but there's no wrinkles in this entire body. I'm 64. My husband's like, you don't have no wrinkles. No, I don't. Job 33:24. You should say it too. And it's not too late for you to say it. I told Pastor Susan, I talked to her about a month ago, and I said, that scripture has been mine since the day you gave it to me. That's what I say. I speak the word over my body every day. I get up. No evil will befall me. Neither shall any plague come near my dwelling. I did not get COVID. None of that. I have no sickness and disease in my body. I take an ibuprofen every once in a while. But that's it. And I pray over that because we should be praying over our medicine. All the benefits, no side effects. I'll have all your benefits. And even over the ibuprofen, I'll have all your benefits and none of your side effects. That's how you have to live. That's how you have to live. Oh, I'm good. I'm good. I was looking at the time. I'm good. I'm good. Okay. Is there anything in your life where you're not obeying the Lord? Something that you're struggling to give up? Something that's holding you in bondage and fear that you don't want to give up?
Yes, right.
Yeah. Look, think tonight, because when you come back and Pastor Terry stands up here, I'm sure she's going to answer a lot of questions that you have about that. Yeah, don't let anything in your life that you're struggling with that you can't give up, no matter what it is, if it's cigarettes, if it's whatever it is, partying, drinking, drugs, men, whatever it is, if it's taking over your life, you're going to have problems. You're going to have problems, amen. Faith is simply taking the next step. Peter took one step to get out of that boat on the water. Peter was doing just fine when he focused on Jesus. When we focus on Jesus, we do great. And he got into trouble when he started looking at the storm and took his eyes off Jesus. When we take our eyes off Jesus, oh my goodness, that's when the storms come. That's when the storms come, when we take our eyes off of him. We have to look to him every day, every day. And he's real, people. He's not God Almighty. He's right there on the inside of you, and he wants to talk to you. Huh?
He is God Almighty.
He is God Almighty. What did I say?
I said he's not, but he is.
He is God Almighty. I'm sorry. Not he is God Almighty, and he lives on the inside, and you can talk to him just like I talk to my husband, just like I talk to my pastor, just like I talk to my family, my church family, people that know the Lord. I try to stay away from the others because I don't want any influence. I love them. I'll be there for anybody. I'll pray for them. I'll help them. I'll encourage them. But we got to be around people that are speaking life, speaking the word of God. Amen. If we take our eyes off of him like Peter did, he started looking out that storm. So often we fixate on fear. But it wasn't the fear that sank Peter. Jesus didn't say, why did you fear? He said, why did you doubt me? Why did you doubt me? Why did you doubt me? I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. All things. All things. That was in verse 30 where it said that. Why did you doubt me? When Peter saw the wind, he became afraid. He began to fear when he took his eyes off Jesus and looked at that storm. Doubt crept in and he began to sink. When we take our eyes off Jesus, problems come. When we don't see him in what's happening around us, we lose focus. We got to see him in every area of our life. Every area of our life. Every area. When we don't see him and what's happening around us, we lose focus. When we when we, what can take our eyes off Jesus? Some of us, it may be a pride thing. We'll be looking around like the we're looking around at the disciples, like the disciples did, afraid. But Peter didn't look back and say, "Look, I'm walking on water." He didn't take his eyes off Jesus. We could be doing everything fine and everything's going great in our lives. Oh, I'm walking on water. Everything's going great in my life, in my marriage, in my job, in my finances. Everything's doing good. And we take our eyes off of him.
That's right.
We look away and say, okay, I don't have to do that for a while because everything's going great. I don't need to. I can, just for a minute, I can take my eyes off of him. But we can't. We can't. And it's not something that's tedious and hard. It's awesome. It's a pleasure to keep our eyes on the Savior of the world. He came and died for our sins. Jesus was beaten beyond the recognition of a man for you, for me. I keep my eyes on him because he paid everything so that I can stand here and preach this word to you tonight. Did I want to get up here? Absolutely not. Pastor Terry, Pastor Kurt put me in charge of women's ministry. That was fine. I was good. I could plan. I could decorate. I could come up with the theme and get everybody going, and it'd be beautiful. And Pastor Terry would preach, and that would be great. And Pastor Kurt said, "Rose, you got a lot of things to say." I was like, "Pastor, I don't have a lot of things to say. I'm like Gideon. I'm the least in my tribe. I'm the one that sits in the corner. I was a 3-pound baby girl who read all the time, didn't want to do nothing." Pastor Terry started calling me Minister Rose. I'm like, "Don't call me that." What? Say it. What did I do? Yeah, you changed it. You was trying to get in there. So I was, yeah. And I was like, "No, that was my dad, and I don't have nothing to say." And we went on a retreat. Where were we? In Bradenton. And I was supposed to teach. And I got up early in the morning and I went to the chapel or where the auditorium was, and they have a little coffee thing where you can sit. And I went in there with my Bible. I was like, "Lord, I don't know what to say. I don't have nothing to say." And he laid me out on the floor and he showed me my life. And he showed me what he had for me and who he was. That he was my God, that he loved me. "I have a plan for you, Rose, and you're gonna tell everybody what God has done for you. You're gonna get in my word and you're gonna preach it." I just laid there and just cried. And I got up and I preached, and I had shoes and I kicked my shoes off and I ran around, and we have pictures. I broke my shoe. I broke my shoe, right, Bonnie? I broke my shoe. And I walked around, and God just poured out. And women were standing and weeping. Pastor Angie, she was one of our speakers. She was like 9 months pregnant, and she's jumping and screaming. And I'm like, "Oh, my God." It was like we were praying. It was like, but God just poured out, and he showed me, "This is what I have for you to do. So you better do it." And I've been doing it ever since. Amen. I mean, it took me a while. I had to write my notes out every time and give it to Pastor Kurt and Pastor Terry to read my messages. And, you know, as I'm growing and learning, and they were like, "Oh, Rose, change this to this, and then it'll be okay." You know what I'm saying? Would tweak it, and because I wanted to be right. But now God just has poured out. And I always tell Pastor Kurt, "Pastor Kurt, I have a lot to say." Yes, you do, Rose. But I'm just saying, when we surrender to him, you don't know what plans he has for you. You might not be up here teaching, but somebody needs to hear your voice. They can only hear your voice. So there's people, we have to be prepared, just like with that lady that called. And I could pray with her. Just somebody was in the bathroom this morning and they were having stomach ache. I said, "Okay, let's take care of this right now." And she walked out the door. She's like, "Rose, I feel better already." I know, because his word works. It's not me. It's his word. And it works. It works. Oh, thank you, Jesus. What is distracting you from keeping your eyes fixed on God? Does everything seem to be going sideways, out of control? Can you identify what is it? Call it out and go to battle against the lie that the enemy's trying to tell you, like fear. Go to whatever it is. If it's sickness in your body, go to battle. Go to battle. Where's Georgia? She's in the back. She came from California. She went back to California when I was going through the divorce. She called me up, and she had heart problems since she was young. And she called me up, and she said, she was in the hospital. My twin gets on the phone. Well, everybody has to die, Rose, at some point, because my dad and mom died early. I said, put her on the phone. I said, Georgia, do you want to die? She said, no. I don't want to die, Rose. Get in your car and get to Florida. And she came. And she sat on this word, and she grew, and she grew in the word, but she still had the heart condition. She still had the high blood pressure, congestive heart failure. Sunday morning, Miss Flo, she woke up, and she needed to go to the hospital. She just was sick. She didn't know what was wrong, so I was going to come to church and let them know that I wouldn't be there that day. So I came here. Miss Flo got in the car with me. We went to the hospital. She had congestive heart failure. Her blood pressure was like 200 and something over 179, something crazy. And not yet. So they put us in a room. Pastor Kurt and Pastor Terry, a lot of people came from the church. They said, nobody in the room that's moved by all the wires. They can't come in because we don't need her to get in fear. Only people who are of faith. Miss Flo, there's just a few other people. I don't think anybody was. Shlo was there. Miss Flo was there. Janet was there. Just a few people. Everybody stayed in there. Pray out here, but you're not coming in. Okay, so they prayed. So I finally went home like at, I don't know, like 10 o'clock. And at 1 o'clock in the morning, they called and said, Rose, she just had a stroke. So I went to the hospital. And they came in and they said, okay, we can give her this medicine that will, you know, reverse the stroke, but she could have brain damage. So who do you think I called? I called my pastors. I said, this is what they're saying. They're like, Rose, you've been in this word long enough. Go get somewhere quiet and listen to the Lord. I said, okay. So I went and sat in the stairwell, and I prayed in the spirit, and I heard no. I heard no. So I told the doctor no. He's like, well, it'll be too late. We won't be able to do it. I said, no, we're not doing it. I told Georgia. I looked in her eyes. I said, I'm not doing this. She just shook her head. She didn't know her address, nothing, anything. So about 8 o'clock in the morning, she had the second stroke. So I'm thinking, did I really hear from God? Did I really hear from God? It's like, no, I heard from God. I heard from God. Miss Flo was there. She's praying in the spirit. The nurse comes in. She had a fit. You're those people, huh? The lady who did physical therapy, there was a little nurse's aide that helped. About 8 o'clock at night, she had the third stroke. I was like, really, did I hear from God? I had to hear. I called my pastors. Rose, stay in faith. Stay in faith. So that was Sunday. Monday, you know, they were working on her. Tuesday, so Pastor Kurt hadn't come. Pastor Terry came. Her mom came because her and Georgia are really close. She's our mom, Florida mom, too, like Miss Betty. So they were like, why hasn't Pastor Kurt come? I said, he'll come when the Lord tells him. Okay. I'm not worried about it. He's going to be here. So Tuesday evening, he came. So me and Janet were there. And we were in the room, and all her veins had collapsed, so they were going to put the IV in her neck. So they came, Pastor Kurt and Pastor Terry came. So me and Janet came out, and we were sitting in the waiting room talking and praying and just believing God or just, you know, fellowshipping together. And so we sat out there. I don't know. I don't remember how long. Maybe like 15 minutes, 20 minutes at the most. So Pastor Kurt comes out, and he's like, hey, girl, you need anything before I go? I'm like, oh, no, Pastor, we're good. He's like, okay, I love you. You know, and that's Pastor Kurt. He's not going to And so me and Janet sitting there thinking they were working on her. So Pastor Terry comes out and she's like, why are you guys sitting out here? I'm like, well, we didn't think we could go in. We go in, Georgia's sitting up. She's singing songs to the Lord. And I'm like, what happened? What happened? Later she told me, she said, Pastor Kurt laid hands on her to pray. She put her hands over his, and whatever he spoke, the word he spoke, something clicked, and she was well. Amen. That was Tuesday. Wednesday, we moved up to a room on the floor that you get ready to go home. Thursday morning, Miss Betty picked us up, and we went home. Georgia has not had a heart problem, blood pressure problem. She was taking 23 medications a day. 23 medications. Do you take any medication, G? Nope. No high blood pressure. Oh, Pastor, that was one of the things that Pastor Kurt said, that we had our church Christmas party. He's like, she's going to be at the Christmas party on Friday or whatever. Saturday night, she's going to be at the Christmas party. My daughter flew in. I came here because I was helping, getting everything ready. Georgia came to the Christmas party. She didn't stay long, but she came to the Christmas party, like Pastor Kurt said. And I remember Pastor Kurt and Pastor Terry, tears when they saw her come in. God is so faithful. She hasn't had no problems. None. She has a testimony. Ask her the rest of it because there's more. Amen. God is good, though. He's so faithful. He's so faithful. So you never take your eyes off Jesus. John 16:33 in the Amplified. I'm almost there. 16:33. I have told you these things, that in me you may have perfect peace and confidence. In the world you will have trials and tribulations and distress and frustrate. Trials, tribulation and trials and distress and frustration, but be of good cheer. Take courage. Be confident, certain and undaunted, for I have overcome the world. I have deprived it of the power to harm you. That's our God. So when trials come, it's not him. We live in a fallen world. The enemy is roaming like a roaring lion, seeking who he may devour. We're with people who are not perfect. We see what's going on in this world. He said we will have trials and tribulations, but be of good cheer. Because I've overcome it for you. I've overcome. And he didn't give it a time frame. So sometimes we stay in trials long, further than we anticipate. But he knows the plan. And he knows the purpose. And he knows how to do it. We don't have to help him if we just listen to him. Because when we help him, we get off track. And we take steps back. But if we keep our eyes on him and stay undaunted, this is going to pass. We speak not the problem, but the solution. So many people are speaking what's going on in their lives and telling the whole world and everybody who listens, and the enemy's listening too, and he's like a roaring lion. So, okay, I know what to do because they're speaking this. I know what to do. I know how to stop this. I know how to thwart this. I know what to do. Stop. Stop. You know what? I'm an overcomer. I overcome the world, the flesh, and the devil by the blood and lamb, and my testimony. That's what I say. I don't repeat what's going on in my life. Amen. I don't want the devil to get in the middle of it. I speak life. Yes. This too shall pass. Yes. Lord, I don't know when, but I trust you. Lord, I don't know how, but I trust you. I trust you with every area of my life. I trust you, and I'm not going to get in fear because I know you got me. You brought me through so many things. Sitting in a crack house with my baby, waiting. Didn't even know I was left there. And God saved me from so many things. So many things. So many different trials and tribulations. He saved me. And then I didn't know them, and I was having panic attacks and all those things. I didn't even know what they were panic attacks, but I knew to speak the word. I would lay there, and I would say every scripture, every Bible verse, everything I could think of until I got relief. And the only time I got relief was to speak his word. Speak life. Speak life. Don't speak your problem. Speak your solution. There's all these promises, whatever you're going through. Find them. Put them everywhere. When COVID was going on, I put one on my mirror in my bathroom that I still say to this day over myself. I still say it. I never got it. I still say it every day. No virus, no, nothing can come against me. Put it where you can put your eyes on it every day till it changes. Till it changes, and it will. But we can't lose hope. We can't lose faith. We can't quit, because that's what he wants us to do. He puts us in this fierce phase of our life, and we can't see the solution, but he has it. If you just trust and obey him, trust him. Trust him. He loves you with an everlasting love. He loved you before he knew you. In your mother's womb, he knew the plans that he had for you. He knows you. He sees you. Just like he sees you. Take that personally. God sees me. He knows what I'm going through. He sees me. I think that all the time. He sees me. Nothing goes that he doesn't know about. He sees every pimple on my face. He knows my whole being, inside and out. And he loves me. And he loves you the same way. He loves you the same exact way. Amen. When you're tempted to look at the storm around you, look up. Keep your focus, the eyes of your heart focused on Jesus. Write this down. I don't know if Cal can put it up fast, but I'm going to get through. We're going to start praying for people soon. Keep your eyes focused on Jesus. Psalms 56:3 says, when I am afraid, I put my trust in you. When I am afraid, I put my trust in you. That's in the Bible. It's right there. You can see it. Amen. Look for Jesus and keep looking to Jesus. Look for him and look to him. Although the storm surrounded him, Peter looked to Jesus. And he said, save me, help me. The principle is clear, especially when life is turbulent, chaotic. Look for Jesus. Keep looking to Jesus. And what does looking Jesus look like for you? Psalms 34:4 says, I sought the Lord, and he answered me, and he delivered me from all my fears. What's up? What next step has Jesus asked you to take? Faith unleashes the supernatural. Peter didn't experience the supernatural power of God that allowed him to walk on Jesus until he trusted, as evidenced by his actions. He trusted Jesus. Is there anything different that you need to be doing in faith? Is there anything you need to be doing differently in faith? Fear will sink you. Peter had faith. He walked on water. When he began to fear, he sank. The same is true for you. Fear will sink you. Is there anything gripping and controlling your decision making? Jesus saves us from many things. Jesus not only saved Peter from hell when he accepted him as the Messiah, Jesus saved Peter from drowning. When we accept Jesus, he will save us from drowning. We accepted Jesus. He's going to save us. I don't know how, and I don't know when. It took 24 years for me to get to the place where he could save me, but he did.
That's right.
And it's all worth it.
Yes.
And he redeemed the time back so that I can live the life that he has for me. Because I don't plan to walk out of here early. Pastor Kurt says 120. And that's Jesus, you know, if Jesus tarries, but if he comes back, I'm ready to go. I'm ready to go. But I can have a good, abundant life. I can be, I don't see Miss Sylvia here tonight, but I can be like Miss Sylvia. She gets upset when I tell people her age, but and the this woman, Miss Flo, stand up, turn around, let him look at you. She would tell me. She would correct me. She would say, Rose, don't say it like that.
I don't care. My age is 88.
And I'm 88, I know. And she saved my life. She would tell me, Rose, I don't think you should say it like that. It's like, okay, what do I say, Miss Flo? And so many people, God just surrounded me, has surrounded me for all these years with so many people who have just poured into my life. Amen. Amen. He does love me. You do too, and I love you. A little faith is better than no faith. He can work with a little faith. Jesus spoke of Peter's little faith. Oh, you of little faith. Matthew 17:20 says, if you have faith as a mustard seed, the tiniest seed on the planet, you will say to the mountain, whatever's happening in your life, you will say to the mountain, you move from here to over there. And it will obey you. It will. It will move and nothing will be impossible to you. We can't go another day in fear. We can't go another day in fear. Amen. We can't go another day in fear. Amen. 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 God has things for us to do. We can't do it in fear.
That's right.
And we can do all things through him because he strengthens us. And he gives us the wheels every day. Pastor Curry had this saying on his calendar, because I have this calendar and keep his calendar. And it said, I will to do his will. Uh-huh. And I was like, man, that is good. So at 7 o'clock in the morning, 3 o'clock in the afternoon, and 10 o'clock at night, my phone says, I will to do his will. That's my entire life. I will to do his will, not Rose's will. Because my will can get out of whack, but his will never get out of whack. I will to do his will. And every time it comes up, I say, thank you, Jesus. I will to do your will. What do you want me to do today? What do you have for me today? Thank you, Jesus. That means we are capable of even greater sustained faith. The men in the boat apparently had no faith. They didn't step out. They were like, Peter, no, don't go. Doubt on an emotional level is wavering between belief and unbelief and disbelief. Doubt on an emotional level is wavering between belief and disbelief. It may involve uncertainty, distrust, or lack of belief about certain facts, actions, or motives or decisions. Doubt can result in delaying or rejecting what you are believing for. Not delaying, but it can reject it. You can choose either to worry or to worship. And worship is so much better. When you get into the presence of the Lord and you just start worshiping and you just start thinking about his goodness, like that song, his goodness is running after me every day. I love that song. His goodness is running after us and it's with us every day. When we worship, I thank you for your goodness. I thank you for your grace. I thank you for your mercy. I thank you for your protection. I thank you most of all for your love. Because you love me unconditionally. People can get mad at me. He doesn't get mad at me. He convicts me when I do wrong and I say, Lord, I'm sorry. I repent. And he's like, okay. And then I do it again. And I say, I'm sorry and I repent. And he's like, what did you do? I threw that in the sea of forgetfulness. And then it makes me want to do better. It makes me want to live righteously. It makes me want to do right because how is your worship with the Lord going? Praise him before, during, and after the storm, the trial, the doctor's report, whatever it is you're going through. Proverbs 3:5 in the Amplified Classic says, lean on, trust in, be confident in the Lord with all your heart. I think Amy quoted this, and mine. And do not rely on your own insight or understanding. We can't figure it out, but he can, and he can give us the answer. Keep your eyes on Jesus. Do not fear. He's there in the storm. Yes. He's there in the storm. And as the song says, he is a way maker, a miracle worker, a promise keeper, and light in the darkness. That's my God. That is who he is. Amen. Did you receive tonight? Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Who's going to give? Pastor's going to come. Thank you.
Amen. Did you get something? Are you going to do something with it? Amen. That was good. Rose has got a lot to say.
I have more, but I had to cut it down.
Amen.
Yes, I got a lot to say.
You know, God wants so much to get over to us that he is a promise keeper. One of the things that Pastor Kurt taught us early on was that, you know, there was a little catchphrase going on in the body of Christ. If it's still going around, I don't pay attention to it anymore, so I don't know. But there was a little phrase that people said for fear, and it was false evidence appearing real. But if you've been around us any length of time, we've really debunked that myth, right? Because as Pastor Kurt would like to say, if there's a real gun with real bullets pointed at your real head, that is not false evidence appearing real. But what it is an expectation for God's word to fail. It's an expectation that God will not make good on his word. And I know all of us are like, oh, I would never think that of God. You do every time that you're in fear. And that's not me pointing a finger at you. I'm saying we've already established all of us experience fear. But in order to come out of fear, we put our confidence in the word of God over whatever's coming at us. Yes and amen? Yes. Now, I'm going to say this disclaimer, and I also want to say, I enjoy watching The Chosen. But I will never get my doctrine from The Chosen because I disagree with a lot of the episodes and the way that the writers have written it out. This is why. There is literally not a single scripture that ever points to Jesus denying to heal anyone. And if it ever happened, at least one scripture would have been written about that. The other thing is, I have a hard time thinking that somebody could be completely immersed in God's love and be completely offended at Jesus for any length of period of time. So there's little things within the episodes that they take really huge liberties in order to make it really relatable to things that people are going through. And kind of our objection to that is you don't have to name Mary Magdalene, Peter, little James, or whoever as the object of your lesson because they're real people. And so I don't have a problem with you exploring these everyday things that we experience. I would just prefer you not name one of the people who we know didn't have a problem as having a problem. Other than that, it makes people very passionate about picking up the Bible and learning about Jesus because he's so relatable. So I'm not condemning The Chosen. We enjoy watching The Chosen, but again, don't ever get your doctrine from there. Okay? But the illustration of that was the same raging storm before Peter stepped out of that boat. It was the same raging storm going on while he's walking on water. And then when he chose to get distracted, when he allowed the same circumstances that were already going on, that's when problems arise. That's a truth for sure. So anyway, I just wanted to put that out there for you so that you could chew on that for a little bit, because I also don't want you to have seeds of doubt in your heart, because I will tell you emphatically, Jesus will never say to you, I'm just going to let you sit in this trouble for a little while longer because it's going to strengthen you. That's not what strengthens us. The writers of The Chosen have never sat under Pastor Kurt's teaching. It's very evident, very clear. But it's okay. We totally appreciate what they've done because they've made Jesus relatable and real to people. And well, that's what I was just saying is we're just not going to get our doctrine from there. But We want for you to receive everything that God has for you here at this retreat. And so we're gonna pray for you. I'm going to let Diane come up and explain exactly how we're going to do this. But Amy, Rose, and I are going to be up here to pray for you guys. And so if you are interested in prayer, please come up. If you are not interested in prayer, just honor that other people are going to be receiving. So let's just keep an honor of worship, an attitude of worship tonight. Amen.